So good morning, everybody. Thank you, Arthrix, for the invitation to Munich. It's a pleasure to talk about our experiences with the internal brace technique and the ACL repair today. I'm coming from the trauma hospital in Linz. We've done like 150 cases so far. And looking back in history, we found that the first ACL repairs has been done by thoracotomy Robson in the end of the 19th century. At that time, it has been the gold standard for the ACL techniques, and several techniques has been described in the following years. Up till 1982, when Werner Müller described his results in the famous book, The Knee, and he found that in one-third of his patients, he had good results, in one-third of his patients, he has acceptable results, but in one-third of his patients, he had bad results. So that made us change our technique to the reconstruction, which is the gold standard nowadays. So the question is, when we do the ACL repair, is it something we've done like 100, 200 years ago, or is it something new? And is the internal bracing concept something new? And I do believe yes, because of the fiber tape we use for internal bracing the ACL to get a better healing. And as Gordon says, the internal brace should act as a seat belt, so it shouldn't be over-tightened, so it should allow some micro-movements to get biological healing, as we do also in our fracture cases with the bridging plates. We all know that the fiber tape has an excellent safety report, but it's not just a term of biomechanics, it's also about respecting the soft tissue. So that's my technique of harvesting the tendon posterior medially for the all-inside technique. And we do know that in our gold standard, of course, we create a permanent weakness by harvesting the tendon. We do know that the revascularization of the graft may be incomplete. We have a revision rate from 5 to 15% through literature. So even in our gold standard, we have problems to face. So the technique of the ACL repair is dependent for us, or the indication is dependent for us, on the type of tear, of the localization of the tear, the time to surgery, and the quality of the ligament. For us, the best indications are those with the Shearman 1 classification, the bony avulsion at the femoral side. It might be possible to do the ACL repair and the Shearman type 2 classification, but we don't do it and wouldn't do it in the Shearman 3 and Shearman 4 classification. And that's due to vascularization. Due to time of surgery, we do the surgery in the acute setting if possible. We don't do it in the first and second week after the trauma because of the risk of arthrofibrosis. And we do it then after the third week up to the sixth week. But we have to tell our patient honestly that the indication to do the ACL repair can just be done intraoperatively. So therefore, we go for week three, because otherwise, if we would need to do an all-inside technique, for example, we would have this risk of arthrofibrosis. According to the Shearman classification, we need to look at the vascularization of the ACL, and we see that the vessels come in from the tibial stamp as well as from the proximal part. So there's a white zone in between. And if the rupture is intraligamentary, in this white zone, we can't expect a proper healing there due to our understanding. In terms of instruments, we started doing it with a labral scorpion. We changed now to the meniscal wiper for several reasons. We started with a fiber snare to catch the ACL stamp, and changed now to the fiber wire, to two fiber wire, which we use now. We use a fiber stick as a guiding wire. For the bracing construct, we use the tightrope RT and the fiber tape. And for tibial fixation, we do use a swivel lock or an ABS button. So those are our surgical steps. We see the MRI with a proximal rupture. We see the arthroscopic view with a proximal rupture. And then we use the meniscal wiper to catch the ACL stamp. We've seen problems with the scorpion that we needed times, or 5 to 6 times, to get the fibers through the ACL stamp. And it's much more easier with the meniscal wiper. And we do it two times, as you see on the right-hand picture. And then we try to get our guiding wire with a fiber stick straight through the ACL up to the proximal rupture site. Then we do the femoral drilling after microfracturing at the femoral insertion site. And then we bring, by anteromedial drilling and using a guiding wire, the fibers out through the femur. And then we attach it and knot the fiber wires to the tightrope button. So this is a case. You also see the MRI. You see the intraoperative torn ACL. It's also a PL bundle rupture. And this is at the end of the surgery. So you see the reattached ACL. You don't see almost any fibers there, just at the proximal part where the fiber tape comes out. In terms of our post-op protocol, it's pretty much the same in the beginning as we do in our reconstruction cases. So we don't use a brace. We do limited weight bearing for the first 7 to 10 days. There's no limitation in the range of movement. It's just like in the comfort zone of the patient. The patients get physiotherapy twice a week. All follows an integrated care pathway. We change the protocol to the reconstruction cases after the 4 months, because then, as you see in this judo girl from the Austrian judo team, in the 4 months we allow sport-specific training, and we allow them to go back to sport after 6 to 7 months. So the advantages of the internal brace technique in our hands is that we don't have a donor site morbidity, we have a restoration of the proprioception, we have a faster rehabilitation program, and a shorter back to work and back to sport time. And when I started the technique, for me, it was important to see that a secondary ACL reconstruction is possible at any time, in any method you want, so you don't need to fill up a bone hole, or so you're free of your choice. Of course, there are disadvantages. One of them is that the early surgery is recommended, so there's a certain part of patients which are copers and they would cope with the problem and would feel good with a torn ACL, so we might overtreat some of the patients. The technique is not suitable for any patient, and we're still missing long-term results. In terms of literature and long-term results, there's one study done by De Felice. It's a small group, a level 4 study, but the interesting thing is the follow-up of 3.5 years, which is the longest follow-up we do have now in literature. And in the KT-1000, they have an elongation in 7 out of 8 patients less than 3 millimeters. As pointed out by Adrian, for us, the perfect indication is in the child cases. This is a 12-year-old patient. Accident was a bicycle. Surgery was done 4 weeks after the trauma, and I've seen him 4 months after the surgery a couple of weeks ago. He's doing perfectly. He has no pain, free range of movement, and in the KT-1000, he has an instability or an elongation of 1 to 2 millimeter compared to the healthy side. Another indication at the group around Professor Frosch and Heitmann has published are the multi-ligament injury. There are promising results in those cases. So to sum up, the internal brace is a biological healing concept with a new technique. It should act as a seatbelt, so it shouldn't be over-tightened. The healing of the ACL in an anatomic position, in our opinion, is possible. And it's also a new treatment option, not just for the ACL, also for other ligament ruptures. But like in any technique, the right indication is a base for good results. So I thank you for your attention.